Good day, everybody. It's Trent Klarenbach with Klarenbach Research. Today is July the 29th, 2025, and I want to share with you a video that encompasses and accompanies our 2024 Iowa Farmland Value Study. Now, this Iowa Farmland Study is a third in a series of studies we are doing regarding farmland in various jurisdictions in North America. The first one we did is in Saskatchewan. We followed that up with Alberta. Now this Iowa Farmland Study is the third in that series. We look to be doing some other states as well, and perhaps other provinces. We're going to follow the Iowa State University Farmland Value Study from 1941 to 2024, their model for using and converting the nominal farmland values into 2015 inflation-adjusted dollars. Prior to 1941, we're going to rely on the USDA National Agriculture Statistics Service, where they estimated Iowa farmland values, which included buildings, inflating the land values slightly, and we'll convert that into inflation-adjusted values for 2015 dollars using the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics CPI index. Now, in the study, we're going to employ some technical analysis methods, some very foundational, very basic technical analysis methods in our attempts to identify what happened in the past and see if that can provide some clues as to what will happen in the future. Now, the various methods we're going to be using a logarithmic scale. Let me just switch to the chart right now and you can get an idea of what we're looking at. We're going to be using the logarithmic scale. Now, that it's a chart scale that percentage changes equally rather than absolute values on the y-axis. It's used for long-term data to visualize exponential growth and reduce distortion. What can happen is when you have a drastic rise in values over a long period of time, it's very difficult to see the fluctuations in those values on an arithmetic chart where we have equal distance between the price levels and the y-axis. So what I like about this is when you have an increase in value from say $2,000 to $4,000, it really displays that in the same context as an increase from 4 to 8. So it's a 100% increase, and that's reflected on the y-axis. I think it's very valuable, and a lot of market technicians prefer to use it over the arithmetic chart itself. We also look at some trend lines here. If you're unfamiliar with the term, it's a straight line connecting two or more price points on a chart. It helps to identify the direction and strength of a trend, and upper and lower trend lines can signal resistance and support levels. We will also look at the relative strength index. It's a momentum oscillator that measures the speed and change of price movements on a scale from 0 to 100. Readings above 100 are considered overbought, while readings below 30 are considered oversold. So whenever you hear the term something is overbought or oversold, they're most likely referring to the relative strength index. We will also look at some Fibonacci retracements. Now there's about five different levels which I consider key, which I use for my analysis. One is a 3.6% retracement. The second one is a 38.2%, the 50%, 61.8%, and also the 78.6% retracement. They are those Fibonacci retracement levels are commonly used to anticipate areas of support during price corrections, and we'll see if they have any impact on the past price pullbacks and corrections of Iowa farmland. The study also takes a look at Elliott Wave analysis. We'll look at the Elliott Wave theory. We're not going to cover that in this video right now, but there is some greater context and some chart and a chart to show in the study itself for you Elliott Wave enthusiasts. We will also look at the decline and duration analysis in the study, and we'll talk about that a bit in this chart here. I think it's very interesting when we look at where the peak value was, where the trough value ended up, and how long it took to get there. Not only that, we like to see how long it took to recover back to those previous peak levels, and that purchasing power of Iowa farmland. I think it's quite interesting to see, and it might be quite surprising for most of you viewers and readers. But let's take a look at this chart here right now. We're going to some greater detail here. You will see a black line here. Now that is the inflation adjusted price of Iowa farmland from 1920 to the year 2024. So it encompasses 140 years. Now again, as a reminder, the nominal values have been adjusted for inflation using the 2015 dollars. So you're going to see, you know, these numbers you see here might not be your experience, but that's how we're arriving at that, at this analysis. We're following the Iowa State University's land value study, which I think is very credible and very well done. So let's take a look at what's happened here in the past. The first considerable correction that I identified on the chart occurred following the peak in 1922, and it declined down for 11 years before finding a bottom in 1933. So it took 11 years. The price correction was 59%, quite significant. So you will remember how we talked about that 50% and 61.8% correction. You know, that falls right in, it's close to, it can be close to both of those values if you want, probably closer to that 61.8 fib retracement level. Why is a 61.8 important? It's interesting how we see how often in the public markets, whether it's, you know, the stock market, commodities, currencies, bonds, cryptocurrencies, how often that ends up being kind of a bottom, get near that level, that's a bottom in the correction, and a rally often happens at that level. Something we look for, some algos are programmed to trigger at that level, trigger buy orders. It also happens in non-public markets, such as the Canadian special crops markets. We see the same thing happening in the lentils. We see it in yellow peas and green peas. We see it in canary seed. It's quite remarkable. We see it in cash durum, and it's really remarkable how the same level acts as support often when nobody else is looking at the chart, and likely nobody is making decisions based off the chart itself. So following that pullback, that 11-year pullback ending in 1933, this 59% retracement, we saw just a gradual, nice little staircase climb up until the 70s. And of course, we had that commodity boom in the early 70s. A lot of reasons why that happened. You know, you can throw in gold, talk about Russia, and you can also talk about oil. So there's all those events happened in the early 1970s. And instead of that staircase climb continuing, it took an elevator up, reaching a peak in 1979. So that's the inflation adjusted peak, was in 1979. I think the nominal value was in 1980, but nonetheless, we're using inflation adjusted values here. So then following the peak in 1979, we saw a decline for 7 years, a decline that dropped in value by 73%, quite significant. So, you know, fell between that 61.8, 78.6% retracement, which I find quite interesting. It's probably as more interesting as this. Take a look at where the bottom was in Iowa farmland. It lines up very closely with the previous high in 1922. So what happens is 1922 would have been a resistance point. And when you're studying the charts and using technical analysis, you anticipate a break of resistance to be retested at some point in the future. It never happens quite as quickly as you anticipate, but we anticipate it will. And I would argue this exact same thing happened, albeit 64 years later, right? But it came down, found support, I would say close to a fib level, but more importantly at this previous resistance. This is classical technical analysis chart patterns right here, in my opinion. And then we saw that rapid rally, I guess, from 1986, which really started to accelerate around 2007, 2010. And, you know, again, a staircase up, and then I would argue it took the elevator up to, again, its high in 2013. And again, we saw a five-year correction ending in 2018, but that five-year correction was 23% drop in inflation-adjusted farmland values. So the purchasing power of that farmland dropped by 23% in that period of time. It didn't quite come down and test this previous resistance back here in 1979, but it got darn close, right? Now, sometimes close is good enough, but it's interesting enough to see that we did have a pullback, got down close to those levels, but maybe more importantly, it hit that close to that 23.6 Fibonacci retracement level, right? All these indicators are just tools to help you give some idea of where buyers might step in or sellers step in. And when they get aligned, of course, their conviction certainly strengthens. And then following that, we saw now another rally up to 2023. Last year's farmland values dropped from 2023 to 2024. And it's quite interesting to me. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit further or a little bit later in this video. But let's drop down to this bottom panel. You'll see this blue line here. This is the relative strength index I mentioned earlier. And when you get to extreme overbought conditions, there's certainly a caution flag. Maybe they're a red flag, but there's certainly an area to be aware of. And it signals a over well, simply an overbought asset. And it's, you know, take a look at these RSI levels at these peaks. So the 1979 peak RSI was at 92.70. 2013 it was lower, 88.85, and then 2023 that peak was 75.93. So it's interesting. The RSI can often provide information of where the price can go, but maybe more importantly, what's happening here. This is a setup for what I call a bearish divergence, and it's one of my favorite chart pattern and use of technical analysis that often signal a top in the market. So what is bearish divergence? So it's a situation where you have higher prices. So I like having, I call it triple bearish divergence. So if I get three higher prices and I look at the RSI, and when I have three lower, then that's what I call bearish divergence. So I have three higher price levels that correspond with three lower RSI levels. So 892, 88 down to 76. Okay, so to me, I look for these patterns for indications that the market of that asset could be near a top, and start looking for reasons to think it's going to go lower. Now you'll see here that this RSI, after having a correction in 2013, it dropped below 70, fell out of overbought conditions, and then it went back up, and then we got that lower high in the RSI. Well, now the RSI has turned back down below 70. It's at 69.77. It's 2024. You know, this is another sign that this market could be rolling over. So often you'll see the RSI comes down, breaks that 70 level, rallies back up, and then does not make a higher high while the price does. And that rolls over, and when it breaks below 70, it's a major caution, major yellow flag for me. I really want to be on my toes anticipating a pullback in the price. So let's just review that. I got what I call the triple bearish divergence. Okay, total yellow red flag in my opinion. Something I'm watching. We might not have talked about this in the earlier summary, but I also have this red dashed line, and it's an exponential moving average. Now, quite often analysts use a simple moving average. It gives this equal weight throughout that period that's chosen. Maybe it's a 50-period moving average, 200-period moving average, equal weights for each of those periods. This is an exponential moving average. And what it does is it gives greater weighting to the near period. So it's a two-year, so it gives greater weighting to the last year and less to the year before that. So I really think it's interesting. Whenever the prices drop below that, two EMA, I'll call it, two-year exponential moving average, we have seen a decline in prices, okay? Now, most of the time, it's been insignificant or very relatively low. The times when it's been extreme, I would argue, is following the 1979 high, the 2013 high, and also the 2023 high. So does it mean it's going to be a small pullback, small correction, or a significant one? Well, let's take a look at what the other indicators are telling us. So whenever there's been a small pullback in the price, when it's dropped below that two-year EMA, and the RSI is not in overbought conditions, it's been relatively small. When we've been in extreme overbought conditions, which I consider anything above 80 to be extreme, we've had significant conditions. So right now, we saw that in 1979, that 73% pullback. We saw that in 2013. I consider a 23% correction significant when the stock market considers a 20% correction, maybe a recession indicator, or certainly a bear market, then I think we sort of meet that definition. Now we're finding it again. Having trouble with the chart here, but we're finding that again. We just broke below that two-year EMA. Again, total caution flag for me. You know, we're with that bearish divergence, the elevated overbought, I'll use the quotations for overbought, on the RSI. And again, it's a series of indicators and analysis tools that are suggesting that a pullback is imminent. Now, the market doesn't have to pull back. The market does not care what I think should happen or will happen, or the market keep going higher. A lot of people think farmland values will never go down. And, you know, I think we're going to see that test right now, a test of that theory at the moment. But I want to share this with you. I think there's some great information for farmers, great information for lenders, great information for investors in this Iowa Farmland Study. I hope you enjoyed it. If you want to learn more or how to access this farmland study, check the comments, check the description. There'll be a link to the Klarenbach Grain Report. Use that link. You can get a free copy of the Iowa Farmland Study, and it's a free subscription to my newsletter. You can cancel at any time, but I think there's some really good nuggets in there. I talk about corn, soybeans, wheat, canola, currencies, cattle. We cover quite a range of products. So check that out. You can also go to my website, klarenbach.ca. I think there's some great value in my two newsletters there. My name is Trent Klarenbach. It's sunny in Saskatoon. Life's good.